We love you.
See the beauty of the Lord.
So beautiful.
the bridal cry, O God, to see your beauty, to know your glory.
Say Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us this morning and creating a sacred space there in your home. It is our hope that something will be said or done to charge you, challenge you, and to encourage you in faith and in your walk with the Lord. The next few minutes will be a time of worship, word, and witness. And if you wish to be a blessing to this ministry, these are the ways in which you can give: through our website, through text giving, through quick pay and Zelle, and good old-fashioned United States mail.
This is the cry of my heart, O God. To see the glory of the Lord, to see the beauty of the Lord.
Thank you, and let's go to church. Thank you, and let's go to church.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ.
O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving.
For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods.
In his hand are the deep places of the earth. The strength of the hills is also his.
The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
Just lift that up. Oh, I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy, his holy. Yes, he has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. So bless his holy, his holy name. Oh.
Father, in this morning, we bless you, God. We thank you. We lift your name up, God, from wherever we are. We thank you. We praise you because you are God alone. Thank you, Lord, this morning. We rejoice in you because you are the God of our salvation. Lord, we thank you. We praise you, Lord, with everything going on around you, going around us, God. We thank you. We glorify you. You are the God of our salvation. We thank you, oh God, for in the midst of all the uncertainty, there is one thing that we are certain about, that you are still God. Huh? God, you sit on the throne. We are certain, God, that you will indeed bless us, God. Thank you, God. We are certain that you are still in the midst of us. And God, this morning, we're asking your blessing. Bless us where we are. Bless us where we're gathered. Bless us where we're listening, God. Where we're listening, God. Bless us, Lord. Ah, God, let your presence be felt, Lord. Throughout our household, God. Let your presence be felt. Throughout the building, God. Let your presence be felt. Even as we are here in the sanctuary. Bless your people everywhere. Ah. God, bless your people everywhere, God. Lord, you know the conditions. You know the mindsets. Lord, today, Lord, let this broadcast be a broadcast of healing. Ah, God. Lord God, let it be a broadcast of deliverance, oh God. Where folk are shaking, God. Lord God, even today, where faith is wiltering down, God. Lift faith up now, God, in the name of Jesus. Ah, God, this morning, let your presence fall through like a tsunami, God. Let your presence flow through now, God. In the name of Jesus, bless now. Bless the spoken word. Bless the read word. Bless the word that's being sung, God. Lord, let today, God, show your glory. Show your glory. Show your glory. Show your glory now. Ah, God, and we thank you. We praise you. Bless the speaker today, oh God. God, speak a word through him, oh God. Now, God, we thank you and we praise you. Praise you for what you're about to do. Praise you for what you're about to do. We clap our hands. And we call these things done. We decree it. And we declare it. We decree and declare healing. Deliverance. Ah, God. Blessings flow now, God. In the name of Jesus. And it is so. In Jesus' name. Amen.
A reading from the book of Acts, chapter 19, verses 1 to 7. Here begins the reading of God's word. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he had found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became a believer?" They replied, "No. We have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Then he said, "Into what then were you baptized?" They answered, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus." On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Altogether, there were about 12 of them. The word of the Lord.
Song says, "Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life, and I'm so glad you came to save us." Hallelujah. Wherever you are, just clap your hands and let's worship the Lord together. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Lift it up, say, "Lord, Lord, I lift your name on high. I love to sing, Lord, I love to sing your praises. Oh, I'm so glad you're in my life. And I'm so glad you came to save us. Lord, you came. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Oh, yes, I do, oh, Lord, yeah. Oh, Lord, I lift your name on high, yeah. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Oh, Lord, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. And I'm so glad you came to save us. Because you came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, you came from heaven to earth to show us the way, from the earth to the cross. You paid from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, you came from heaven to earth to show us the way, from the earth to the cross. My debt you paid from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. One more time, you came from heaven to earth to show us the way, from the earth to from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Yeah. Lord, I lift your name on high. Higher, Lord. Lord, I lift your name on high. Yes, I do. Lord, I lift your name on high. Oh, Lord, I lift your name on
Happy New Year and welcome to the City of Hope, Greater St. Mary Church. We are one people, one church, with one sound and one praise. Out of an abundance of caution and concern with the recent surge in COVID-19 cases, we have returned to virtual worship. Until it is safe to return to in-person worship, join us on YouTube, Facebook, and in the Zoom Chapel. We are building back greater in historic Bedford-Stuyvesant Heights, Brooklyn, New York. It is our joy to be with you today. As we welcome the new year, we invite you to journey with us in our 21-day consecration, beginning January 2nd and concluding on January 22nd. Details and guidelines are posted on our website, gsmcny.org. We are building back greater. Meet us this week, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 8 p.m. in consecration prayer. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. The information to connect to the Zoom Chapel is in the announcements and the website. This Friday evening, January 14th, we will meet by conference call at 8 p.m. You may dial in at 805-706-4491. We look forward to praying together in faith, believing with God, all things are possible. You are invited to join the Building Back Greater Campaign 2022. Your help is needed. Your pledge is needed. Information to make your pledge for this year will be posted on the website and available at the church office on January 8th. God will return it to you, good measure, pressed down, and running over. Continue to be grateful for your ongoing financial support of the ministry. It is both valued and appreciated. While these are difficult times, your generosity and sacrificial support has enabled us to provide ministry to you and your families. You can help us to continue this work as you give now at gsmcny.org, Cash App, $City of Hope, GSMC, and text 929-377-1110. Your giving makes a difference. Make your gift now. Thank you. Each week together, we create a sacred space in which to share the Word of God, sing His high praises, and to unite in prayer. Please like, share, and subscribe to the City of Hope, Greater St. Mary Church. Thank you for worshiping with us today. Remember, walk in faith, live in hope, and resist the fear. Live in vision and not in your circumstances.
And now we've come to a time of universal prayer where we gather our thoughts and our petitions before the Lord for the world. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Before we ask you for anything, we want to take a few moments just to say thank you. Lord, we thank you for life itself. We thank you for life, oh God. We thank you for health. We thank you for strength. We thank you for this another opportunity to come before you just to say thank you. We thank you for bringing us over from 2020 to 2021. We thank you, oh God. Lord, we made it over and we want to say thank you. We thank you for sparing us, oh God, from many of the calamities that hit other people. We're not grateful that it hit them, but we want to thank you that in spite of everything we went through, you brought us through, you brought us over. And we want to say thank you, God. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your loving kindness, oh God. We want to take time to bless you with the breath you give us in our lungs. We thank you, oh God, with the breath you give us in our lungs. We honor you, we glorify you, and we magnify you. Now, God, we pray in the name of Jesus for the nation worldwide, oh God. We ask in the name of Jesus that you would look upon our nation, the United States of America, oh God. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would look on this country, oh God, that you would look on this nation at large, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, look on President Donald Trump right now, oh God, in the name of Jesus. He has only a few more days, but we pray in the name of Jesus that in these few days, oh God, that you would touch his heart, that you would touch his mind, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we've seen a lot in these last few days, oh God. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would bring peace, that you would bring tranquility to this nation, oh God. Help us as a nation to seek you wholly, oh God. In the name of Jesus, help us as a nation, oh God, to turn our plates down and to seek you in prayer, oh God. In the name of Jesus, help us to repent, oh God, from the wickedness of this nation, oh God. In the name of Jesus, oh God, where there is division, bring unity, oh God. Where there is racism and discrimination, we pray for justice, oh God. In the name of Jesus, oh God. Oh God, we thank you for our government leaders. Even look upon Vice President Pence, oh God. In the name of Jesus, look upon this present administration, oh God. Keep things as peaceful as they can be as we smoothly try to transition, oh God. Look upon our incoming President Biden, oh God. Vice President Harris, oh God, and their administration, oh God. We pray in the name of Jesus that you would give them wisdom, knowledge, and understanding in how to lead this nation, oh God. In the name of Jesus, oh God, I pray, oh God, that you would look upon all our governmental officials, oh God, our senators, our representatives, oh God, our governors, our mayors, oh God, local community leaders, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Look upon our police departments all over this nation, oh God. Oh God, have mercy upon them. Cover them with your blood, oh God. Look upon all of our essential workers in this nation. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, those who have to go out day by day to be exposed to the elements, to be exposed to the virus, oh God. I pray that you will look upon every essential worker, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And now, God, we call out this COVID-19, oh God. Oh God, I pray, oh God, in the name of Jesus, that those who are even infected now, that you would touch their bodies, oh God. Those who the vaccine has not even reached yet, keep them covered with your blood. In the name of Jesus, We thank you for the vaccine, oh God. I pray in the name of Jesus that it will be distributed equally as it should be, oh God. We come against bad side effects, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. And we thank you for covering us who have yet to receive a vaccine, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We pray that you will look upon our hospitals, oh God. Many are overrun, oh God. I pray in the name of Jesus that you will look upon the doctors and the nurses, everyone affiliated with our care, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. I pray, oh God, that you will look upon our students, those who are doing virtual learning, oh God, even those who may be going in from time to time. Look upon our school systems, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Look upon the teachers and administrators. Look upon the students, oh God, who have adjusted and are still adjusting to the new way of learning, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Look upon every parent, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. Oh God, I pray, oh God, that you would help this nation at large, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Look upon those, oh God, who are sick in their body without even having COVID-19. Those who are dealing with various ailments. We pray for healing, oh God, for you were wounded for our transgressions. You were bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon you. With your stripes, we are healed, oh God. With your stripes, we are healed, oh God. In the name of Jesus, oh God. Lord, I pray for every pastor all over the world who is making decisions whether to return or not, oh God. I pray, oh God, that you would help congregations to even stay together, even during this time, oh God, of Facebook and social media and Zoom, oh God. Unite us as one, oh God. We may not be together physically, but help us to still be able to unite in the spirit, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, now I pray, oh God, that you will look upon those who are looking today, oh God, every home that's represented online, oh God. I pray that you would minister in a special way, oh God. Those who have lost jobs, oh God, have mercy upon them, oh God. Those who are struggling financially, oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would meet every need, oh God. In the name of Jesus, oh God, we believe you for these things. We count them done, oh God. We believe you for great things. Even in this new year, oh God, we believe you, oh God, that the death numbers will be less than last year, oh God. We claim it now. There will be less deaths in 2021. In the name of Jesus, oh God, we believe you for it, oh God, and we count it done, oh God. Look upon those, oh God, who are struggling mentally, oh God, those who are fearful, oh God, those who are anxious, oh God, those who are dealing with various mental health issues, oh God. Look upon those, oh God, who are living in domestic violence situations, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Those who are at the brink of suicide, we come against suicide, oh God. We come against depression, oh God, and oppression, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God. And we believe you and trust you for greater this year. We believe you and trust you for greater this year, because we will seek you more, oh God. If 2020 has not taught us but one thing, it is that we need to seek you daily, oh God. Help us to seek you earnestly, oh God. We thank you and we praise you. We give you glory and honor for hearing us, and we believe you for the answers, because you are indeed a prayer answering God. We count these things done in Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. Thank you.
Gave me my hands to reach out to men, to show them your love and your perfect plan. But with my eyes I see a need for more availability. I see hearts that have been broken, so many people to be free. So, Lord, I'm available to you. Ooh, my will I give to you. I'll do what you say do. Use me, Lord, to show someone a way and enable me to say my storage is empty and I am available to you. To you, oh Lord. So I'm giving back to you all the tools you gave to me. My hands, my ears, my voice, my eyes, so you can use them as you please. I have emptied out my cup so that you can fill it up. Now I'm free and I just want to be more available to you, Lord. Oh, Lord, I'm available to you. My will I give to you. I'll do what you say do. Use me, Lord, just to show someone the way and enable me to say, I just want to say my storage is empty, Lord, and I am available. My storage is empty, and I am available. My storage is empty, Lord, and I am available. My storage is empty, and I am available. My storage is empty, Lord, and I am available. My storage is empty, and I am available to you.
Thank the Lord. The Lord is good and he's greatly to be praised in the city of our God and the mountain of his holiness. Let's take this time to thank God for Bishop Chambers and for Pastor Chambers and Pastor Cherie and Pastor King, to everyone here, to all of God's people. Excited to be here for this morning, and I'm going to share what God has given to me, and I'm going to sit down. Psalm 62, verses 1 through 5. Amen. I'm going to share very briefly from the 62nd Psalm, verses 1 through 5. Here begins the reading of God's word. Truly my soul silently waits for God. From him comes my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. How long will you attack a man? You shall be slain, all of you, like a leaning wall and a tottering fence. They only consult to cast him down. from his high position. They delight in lies. They bless with their mouth, but they curse inwardly. My soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. I want to read that fifth verse, is where I'm going to talk on this morning. My soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. I want to talk today from the subject, living with great expectation. Living with great expectation. Our text is found in the book of Psalms, and Psalms is the worship book of the Bible. It displays to us the human interaction with God. One thing we can learn from the book of Psalms is that there is never a time that we should not be in worship. When we are in pain, we worship. When things are going wrong, we worship. Whether we are broke or rich, we worship. Wherever we are, we must always continue to worship. The 62nd Psalm is a psalm of confidence. It was recited by the children of Israel to show their confidence and expectation of God. David is the king, and he's dealing with some type of betrayal around him. It's not clear if this is the betrayal of Absalom or another situation. We just know that David lives in a place that he must always deal with some kind of issue. And that teaches us a valuable lesson that we can learn from the fact, whether big or small, we all have issues. Whether famous or non-famous, we will all have to deal with some type of betrayal or another. The reality is, the higher God takes you, and the more you have the blessing of God, the more you'll have to deal with betrayal. Life happens to all of us, and it will continue. The Bible says it rains on the just as well as the unjust. We get a glimpse into the attitude and approach of David. Listen to how David responds to the issue he is dealing with. He says, "Truly, my soul waits silently upon God." Notice that his response is not to react to his enemies the way they would want him to. He says he is going to wait silently upon God. Isn't that strange that a king with authority and power, one that could have guards come against his enemies in a heartbeat, finds himself waiting in silence? What does that mean? How does one do that in the face of adversity? How does one respond without responding? Well, the next line tells us something that we can take into account. He states, "From him comes my salvation." This word salvation in this particular text means deliverance. Isn't that amazing that David lived in the reality that it is only God that can save him and bring him out of the situation that he was in? A lot of us look to ourselves and what we can do and our strength, but the truth is, only God can handle our enemies. There is the truth in that God is the source of deliverance. It is never another person or instrument. It always points back to God. When we get into troublesome situations and circumstances that would seem to deter us, the person that we turn to speaks a lot of us. Who we turn to in our situation speaks a lot about us. Some of us turn to fighting, others drugs, others alcohol. We use these things as defense and guards to deal with our situation without totally depending and putting our situation into God's hands. We're constantly trying to prove that we can handle it, and in the end, we make a mess of the situations that we are facing. I know you're saying that I trust God. That if we all will tell the truth, we can look back at our lives and see the places that we did not trust God fully, where we did not put it totally into God's hands, but allowed ourselves to be in situations where we made things worse than what we could have been if we had trusted God and allowed him to handle the situation and circumstances that seemed to creep up into our lives. I can look at my own life and see that there have been times that I should have left it alone and placed it into the hands of God
and he would have handled it the way it needed to be. I love the reasons that David gives for his confidence and trust in God. He shows us three descriptions to tell who God is. He says, he is my rock, my salvation, and my defense. He says, he's my rock, my salvation, and my defense. It isn't interesting that he chooses to describe God that way. What is he doing when he says he being a rock, being a salvation, and being a defense? It was the Proverbs writer who said in Proverbs 18:10 that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run in and they are saved. Isn't it good to know that God is a strong tower, that he is a secure tower? The story is told of a city that contained great wealth in it. In it was a great bank that the entire city guarded. It was impenetrable by anyone that tried to rob it until one day, robbers put fire to the barns outside the city. And while the citizens were going outside to put out the fire, they left the bank unguarded and robbers robbed the bank. But God is not like that. He will not leave us when things get hot and when the enemy decides to come after us. He will not run away because he is a strong tower. He will not allow the enemy to rob us or to keep us out of his care, but allows us to know that we can be secure and confident in who he is. Isaiah says in the great and famous scripture that when the enemy comes in like a flood, he will lift up a standard against him. God is our protector. And in an age like today, where the capital is being overrun by crazy folk, we need a God that will protect us even in the midst of violence and adversity. Listen to David's confidence. He states, I shall not be greatly moved. That is bold confidence, because there are things that happen in life that would seem to shake and rock us to our very core. But David was confident when this was happening that he could trust that regardless of what the enemy was doing, that he would not be moved. If there was something that I would encourage you to see, is that regardless of what your enemy does, don't be moved. It bears repeating. I want you to know that God can handle your enemies better than you ever could. That is not just a cliche or something said to get a cheap response, but it is the truth. It is a reality that though you may not always felt like he is there, don't be moved by the strong winds and billows that life may bring. We all have had and are going through something that would seem to shake us, but with God, we have the ability not to be shaken or not to move. I don't care what the enemy brings your way. Trust that God can hold you in spite and despite of your enemies. David dealt with the reality of enemies all around him. He was dealing with all kinds of underhanded and devious people. The sad reality is that it is not too much different today than it was back then. People will always try to take you down. Look at how he looks at his enemies. Verses 3 and 4 tells us, he says, how long will you attack a man? He deals with the fact that his enemies have been developing allies against him. And isn't it always amazing that people are against you will try to find other people that are against you so they can join together and be against you? They may not even like one another, but for the sake of being against you, they'll get together. They'll forget their own issues with one another just to get an ultimate purpose to take you down. And I want to tell you, if you have purpose in your life, you will face betrayal. Remember, Jesus had Judas, but it goes along with the position. And if you know David's story, you know that he was there because God had placed him there. He did not promote himself or manipulate himself into that position. The scripture lets us know that David was on the backside of the field tending sheep, forgotten by his father and his brothers when Samuel called him. Can you imagine that he was forgotten by man, but he was remembered by God? God had made him king, not man. And if man didn't promote him, he couldn't take him down. And that's encouraging to know today that you may have haters and you may have enemies. The challenge is not to be moved, because you got to make the decision to understand that if God has placed you there, there's no one that can move you. Listen to David declaring in the face of his enemies, and I'm almost done, that nothing would move him. Do you have that resolve? Are you convinced that no matter what comes, it may shake everything around me, but I will not be shaken? That makes me praise God, because it let me know that if God has appointed me, no one can move me. This is the place that God has placed me, and I didn't have to worry about it or who's right it is or who's trying to plot against me and trying to take me down. I can trust that where God has placed me and where I am, I shall be everything that God says I will be. The thing that makes me celebrate, and you should too, is that if you weren't blessed, they wouldn't be attacking you. If God hadn't put you there, they wouldn't be trying to pull you down. Listen, one thing you have to know is that elevation brings opposition. God had promoted David, and even if he was promoted, they would try to fight. But as the scripture lets us know, no weapon formed against us shall be able to prosper. And if you're ever going to be everything that God wants you to be, you're always going to have an enemy and an obstacle to where you're trying to go. David lets us know that though he had enemies, they could not take him out of the position that God had appointed over his life. Listen to how he describes his enemies. He says that they bless with their mouth, but curse inwardly in their heart. He says that they were people who posed as friends, but they were really foes. They double talk, they back talk, they're phony. Have you had anyone like that in your life that acted like they were your friends, but really were your foes? It's like the old R&B song that said it this way: smile in your face, all the while trying to take your place. They're backstabbers. They come in and they act like they want to be your friend, but are just full of jealousy. Have you ever had anyone like that in your life? I have, and had more than one. I was in a class back in seminary, and we had a presenter that had been in prison for 70 years, and something he said stood out to me. He said that he had to walk around with his back against the wall because he never knew who was going to try to stab him in the back. The reality is we don't always know who is going to do us in or try to undermine us. But what I love about this text is that David knew who his enemy was. And I do not believe that God always leaves us unaware of our enemies. Sometimes we mistake, but God has a way of revealing the plots and the plans of the enemy. And I want to tell you, don't ever get too comfortable that you don't think that people are not and cannot be used by the adversary. The Apostle Paul, he makes it very clear that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against rulers of darkness, against spiritual wickedness. And a lot of us are dealing with the attacks that if we are not careful, when we can become paranoid to the point we're unable to think straight or even able to understand that even though the enemy may be after us, God is always there. I love how David states his resolve in verse number 5. He states that my soul waits silently for God, for my expectation is from him. How David could talk like this, why he would fix his word to even come out like this. It is because David knew that God, that he knew the God that he was talking about. He knew that the God that he served was able. I did not come to bring a message that would be comfortable or convenient, but to stir your confidence and to bring you to a place to understand that you can expect God to show up in your situation. You can expect God to show up and to show out. David could look at his enemies and say, I know what you're trying to do, but the reality is you can do what you're doing, but sooner or later, I expect God to show up. And I want to tell those under the sound of my voice and those who are listening and streaming in that I want you to expect God to show up. I know that sounds simple, but don't glance over those words without really looking at them. He says, my expectation is from him, meaning it is that God that gave me this expectation. He put this expectation down on the inside of me. Now, in some version, this word is seen as what is expectation. What does expectation mean? Expectation is a strong belief that something will happen. And I want to let you know that God is getting ready to blow your mind. Something is getting ready to happen. I dare you to put in the chat as I get ready to go to my seat that something great is getting ready to happen. But you got to be in the posture of expectation. You got to live at the place that regardless of what you see, I still believe to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. And the question I want to ask on today is, what are you expecting? And are you living in expectation? Because when you expect God, God will show up. God will show up in your crisis with your obstacles in front of your enemies. It's still the psalmist that said, thou preparest the table before me in the presence of my enemies, and my cup runs over. And I came to tell somebody, get ready for overflow to come to your life. He lived through the conflicts with his brothers. He lived through conflict with Goliath. He lived through conflict with Saul. So he could boldly declare, if God could deliver me from that, I know God can deliver me from this. So his expectation was, if God did it before, he'll do it again. The old saints used to say, he may not come when you want him to come, but he's right there on time. I want you to know that God is able to show up in your life. Ephesians 3 is our close. 3 and 20 says, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we ask or think. He's not the only witness. He's able to keep you from falling. Is there a witness in the room that God is able? Can you testify that he'll show up when you're at the worst place in your life? Be not dismayed. Whatever betide, God will take care of you. The story is told. The story is told. You probably heard this before, that a city was in drought. They had a great drought in the city. So all of the faith leaders called a prayer meeting together to pray that they would get rain. And everyone came to the prayer meeting praying for God to show rain. But somebody came in the door and they looked kind of weird because they had a raincoat on, galoshes, and an umbrella. And as they marched to their seat, everybody was looking at them and asking, why are you wearing that? And the person said, didn't y'all say we praying for rain? That means you got to position yourself in expectation of what you believe God to do. And I want to let you know, when you're living with expectation, you will put your umbrella and your raincoat on, because you know that if you're praying for rain, rain is going to come. And as I get ready to go to my seat and I'm trying not to get happy, I want to tell somebody that God's getting ready to let rain come to your life. Is there anybody that's believing God to do something in their life that can say, I expect God. I expect God to show up in my finances. I expect God to show up in my body. I expect God to show up in this nation and this world. I expect God to show up in my heart, on my home. I expect God to show up in my job. I want you to know God is calling us to live with great expectation. And David could say that God would show up, and I want you to know that God did show up. And I want you to know, as I get ready to go to my seat, God's about to show up for somebody that's on the line, that's on the YouTube, that's on the stream. You just need to declare to yourself and everywhere around you that I expect God to show up. I expect him to do what he said he's going to do. I expect him to perform on my behalf. God's getting ready to show up for me because I expect God.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Hallelujah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, oh, for he is good. Yes, he is good, oh, for he is good. Yes, he is good, oh, for he is good. Yes, he is good, oh, for he is good. Yes, he is good.
Universal prayer has already been offered, and I would not assume to go back and revisit that. But what I do feel the unction for is those of you who have just these few minutes been charged and challenged by the message. You've got places and spaces in your life that you have lived there too long. They don't bear fruit. They don't bear joy. They don't bear peace. They don't bear peace. They don't bear love. They don't bear happiness. That's a place that you can today move from. It's not willpower, it's a decision and a choice. You know, happiness, being happy is relive. It's not relative, it's a state of being. You have to choose, you have to decide. It's your mind that you have to make up to be happy. Don't look for somebody to make you happy, because looking for somebody to make you happy is gonna make you more unhappy. And then it's going to make you angry. It's going to make you bitter. And it's going to make you do things. It's going to make you want to do things. Yeah. You're going to start having discussions. Well, I can't do it, but I know somebody who can do it for me. You don't want to do that. Right. You watch enough TV to know that even when you conspire, it comes back to you. You don't want to do that. But today you can make a decision. I need to show up. I need to show up for myself. I need to show up in my own life. And if you've been drinking and drugging, trying to drown your troubles, just know this. You can only drink and try to drown them for so long, and then they learn how to swim. Did you hear what I said? You drink to drown your troubles. And what happens when your troubles learn to swim? Whatever else it is that you do to medicate your pain, I offer you Jesus. The way that Luke describes this woman
bent over, found Jesus today. And you may be bent over in your mind, bent over in your spirit, bent over in your emotions and in your heart. Today's the day. Because you showed up, you can straighten up. Father, we thank you for this time, this moment, and this opportunity that you've allowed us to gather in heart, in mind, and in spirit to be present with you. When we came to worship today, we brought all of us, our past, our present, and our future. And now, God, we offer it to you in the places where we are bent, and even in the places where we are broken. We trust you, God, to loose us from our infirmity, that we may immediately and suddenly be made whole. When we lay down tonight, Lord, give us good rest. Rebuke nightmares and bad dreams. Ghosts of the past who haunt us in the present, put them at rest today in the name of Jesus. We thank you for a change of heart. We thank you for a change of mind. We thank you for a change of spirit, a change of conversation, and a change in direction. We are forward moving, forward looking, and forward thinking. We are loosed from our infirmities in Jesus' name. Thank God. Amen. Clap your hands and bless the Lord. Clap your hands and bless the Lord. Bless the Lord and clap your hands. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And he whom this, if the Son therefore has made you free, you are free indeed. Just point at somebody. It's not polite, but just point at him and say, I'm free. I'm going to stay free. Mm-hmm. We now come to the first communion of the year, where we gather at the Lord's table to remember the blood shed and the body broken for our healing and for our salvation. You are invited to the Lord's table. It was my plan and my intentions that for the entire month of January that we would have communion every Sunday, and we'll figure out how that will happen. We are approaching restrictions and considerations because of what's happening in our world and in our communities, that we safeguard everyone from any possibility of harm. But as you are able, and as time and opportunity will present it, you're able to come to the church to pick up communion supplies. I suggest that you do that. I don't know if we're able to do that today for you that are here that want to take some with you, if that's possible. We will certainly make sure that that happens before you depart. If not, you'll be able to come back and get what you need. But why communion every Sunday? Well, as often as you do this. So, you know, every Sunday is not too much. It's probably not enough. Because there are some faith traditions that commune every day. The body of Christ, the blood of Christ, the body of Christ for your healing, the blood of Christ for your salvation. If ever we needed healing and salvation, it's now. 2 years we have lived lives that we don't recognize, and we're possibly going into a third year. I am not a prophet. God didn't tell me when it was over. And I don't think he told any of the others either. This is me. I don't think so. I think when this pandemic has done what it needs to do, and when I say what it needs to do, and I'm not speaking about the loss of life, but I'm speaking about the loss of self. We have been in routines that we are eager and itching to go back to that yielded no fruit, no benefit to us or for us. We need to abandon that and show up in the new, in the next, in the now. And the only way to do that is to make sure that back is not an option, but forward is the only choice. And so when the children of Israel were in Egypt and the death angel came through, they were told, slay the lamb, put the blood over the door, and eat the lamb so that nothing is lost. I think we're living in a season and a time where we need to eat the body, eat the bread, and drink the cup so that the death angel and whatever harm that is loose in our world today will pass over us. So you're invited today to the Lord's table. It's not my table. If it was mine, I'd pick and choose who would sit at it. But it's the Lord's table. Did you see the first people that was at his table? Yeah. There's one of each one of them represents one of us. Now, somebody will say, I ain't Judas. Well, I hope not. We know how that ended up. But of the 12, there's somebody at that table that looks like and sounds like you. And he didn't tell them to go away. He fed them. And he feeds us today. So you are invited, whoever you are, wherever you may be, wherever you have been, whatever you've done, you are invited to the Lord's table today. After the institution, the Eucharistic ministers will serve you, and then you will certainly, at the words of institution, consume the body, and then you will consume the cup. You'll be healed, you'll be saved, you'll be delivered, and you'll be set free. When we leave worship today, we are departing differently than we did when we came in. Amen. Amen. Shall we stand and let us affirm our faith as we recite the Nicene Creed? We believe in one God. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sakes, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, universal, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Take this time to prepare yourselves to come to the Lord's table.
Mountain. it flow to the lowest valley. Oh, yes, the blood that gives me strength from day to day. It will never lose its power.
The Lord be with you. Also with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right to do so.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, because you gave Jesus Christ, your Son, to die for us, who by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit was made perfect man of the flesh and of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to become your children. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God.
Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, your Son. For in these last days, you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him, you have brought us out of error into truth, and out of sin into righteousness, out of death into light. On the night when he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks to you, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering his death, death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body. Through Christ, and in Christ, and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and peace forever and ever. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so say we each in our own language the prayer that Jesus Christ has taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ has died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Happy are those who are called to the Lord's Supper. Please be seated.
I know it was the blood, I know it was the blood, I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, Jesus died on the cross. I know it was the blood for me. I know it was the blood, I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me, yeah. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross. I know it was the blood for me. They pierced him in his side. They pierced him in his side. They pierced him in his side for me, yeah. One day when was lost, he died on the cross. I know it was the blood for me. The blood came streaming down, the blood came streaming down, the blood came streaming down for me. Yeah. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross. I know it was the blood for me. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross. I know it was the blood for me. They pierced him in his side. They pierced him in his side. They pierced him in his side for me. One day when I was lost, he died. The blood came streaming down. The blood came streaming down. A little of me. Yeah. One day when I was lost, he died on that cross. I know it was the blood for me.
The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Amen.
He's coming back again. He's coming back again. He's coming back again for me. Yeah. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross. I know it was the blood for me. Yeah. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. They pierced him in his side. They pierced him in his side for me. Yeah. One day when I was lost, he died on the cross. I know it was the blood for me. Yeah.
and you have drank from his cup. You've shown by your ways and actions that you're at peace with God and in fellowship with the brethren. Would you now show each other some sign of peace? Peace of God be with you. Peace of God be with you. Let us pray together. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and to serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated as we prepare now to go out into the world and serve and be witnesses. I want to thank you again for being here today, both in the physical chapel and in the virtual chapel, as we have joined in heart and mind and spirit together to worship the Lord. I want to thank you for your liberalities, your generosities, and your sacrifices, and your giving, which have enabled us to come to you week by week and certainly throughout the past year, and our prayer and hope is throughout the remainder of 2022. I want to thank those who gave their New Year's Day offering of $22. And certainly, we don't want to leave you out, because when we get blessed, we want you blessed. And when you get blessed, we want us blessed. So we want to be blessed together. You can do that right now. Please use any of those means that appear on the screen by which you can give your New Year's, your first offering of the year of $22. To the members of this church, I thank you again for your tithes and offerings, your liberalities, your generosities, and your sacrifices in your giving. I want to ask you to continue to do so for those of you that are here in the sanctuary at the end of the service. As you exit, you'll be able to deposit your gifts in the receptacle that's in the rear of the sanctuary. And again, I want to thank you for your giving, be it liberal, be it generous, be it sacrificial, be it the very best you can do. Thank you so much. God is going to return it to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. You're coming out of this pandemic better than what you were when you went in. God is opening your doors. He's making ways for you. If you're visiting with us here today, I would ask that you first give to the church, to where you belong, and to the pastor who supports you daily in prayer, in meditation, and in the study of the word, that you might be fed. And if you have been blessed by fellowship here today with City of Hope, Greater St. Mary Church, we welcome your gifts. We welcome your giving. Your investment in the life and work of the City of Hope, Greater St. Mary Church enables us to tell somebody else it's time for you to show up. Amen. May the Lord bless you real good. Again, we want to wish you a happy new year and trust that the Lord will bless you exceedingly, abundantly, above and beyond, bigger and greater than what you expect. Amen. Go in peace to love each other and to serve the Lord. Amen.
Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him. Blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. From the rising of the same. He's worthy. Jesus is worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Oh, praise him. Oh, Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun unto the going down of the sun, he's worthy. Jesus is worthy. He's worthy to be praised. Ah, yeah, praise him.